And the last song's a message of the whole Bible. Oh, come to the altar.
Bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. go to their classes, Joseph's Church. Start that ahead, start. Okay, so I left my notes at home. I'm hitting the wrong button. My sermon I'm gonna talk on today is focus. Teresa and I have this joke. As we've been studying and Bible study and everything that we've been going over, everything comes back to in the Bible. We need to just keep our eyes on God. He's going to take care of the rest. All the clutter that interrupts you and pulls you away. Her and I just do this. Focus. Just focus. So how do you focus on something important? Let me tell you about Greta. Greta's my other German Shepherd that I have at home. And she has such focus that you call it prey drive. I have cats also in my house. And when the cat moves, Greta goes into this stance. Her tail is straight and her focus on those cats is unbreakable. And I have tried, it's okay, Greta. And her head, it's just like this. Doesn't faze her. I've even put my hands over her eyes. Greta, it's okay, stop. I take them down and she's still there. That's focus. So how do we get our mind focused on God like that? That nothing can distract us. What in the world is going on? As you watch the news, I don't even watch the news. It's just what pops up on my phone, I might see. We've got the Taliban doing all kinds of atrocities over in Afghanistan, and we really need to be praying for those people that are over there. The Christians are being hunted down. There was a lot of Taliban that then they released them from the prisons who had been in there, and there was a judge running and moving and hiding for her life because they're after her. They're worried about the child sex trafficking over there because this is going to create a huge starvation problem. I mean, it's going to be stuff we haven't seen before, and there people will do anything for food, and they're really concerned about this just being expounded, you know. We've got COVID still. Who'd have thought a year and a half ago when they said we had this new virus that we would still be seeing it this long? We've got Hurricane Ida that hit Louisiana with destruction, but went clear up the coast, and New York and New Jersey were devastated. People all over dying. And then down that bottom corner, you've got LA, Hollywood, where the rich and famous live. There's a huge homeless population that are living in tents. And everything he owns is probably in that shopping cart. And then the Haiti earthquake again. I didn't realize Haiti's on 3 fault lines. So yeah, that's worse than California, right? But I think that the death toll is now up to about 2,500, and they're saying other injuries and everything, it's about 5,000 now. Or maybe it was 10,000, but it was enormous. With this hitting the news every day, how do you stay focused on what God's word is telling us? Focus on God. And Psalm 16:8. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. And that's the peace that we should be feeling no matter what's going on. How do you do that? Three simple steps. You got to know God. You got to commune with God. That means having a relationship. You're talking, you're listening. And then you got to obey God. When I say knowing God, I don't mean that 90% of people that call themselves Christians are saying, yes, I believe there's a God. I don't mean that. Or I go to church once a month or on Christmas and Easter maybe. I'm talking about salvation, where you have a personal relationship with God, where you consider him your father. John 3:16, we all memorized that as a kid. God so loved us that he sent Jesus to be tortured to death, basically, as the perfect sacrifice for our sins, so that we would have eternal life. And then cleared all through the Bible. That's what the Bible is teaching us. Revelations. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. That's the relationship I'm talking about. You also have to think of God in the honor and respect. We've been studying Revelations, and I forgot to read our scripture, but this is Revelations 4, and it's talking about the throne room and how, all the praise that goes on. Let's just read it real quick. Surrounding the throne, there's 24 other thrones. Seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their head. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder. In front of the throne, seven lamps were blazing. These are the seven spirits of God. Also in front of the throne, there was what looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. In the center around the throne were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion, the second was like an ox, the third had the face of a man, and the fourth was like a flying eagle. Each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under the wings. Day and night they never stopped saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Whenever the living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay down their crowns before the throne and say, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." That just gives you a little description of heaven and the holiness of it. I don't think we think about that when we come into church, that this is a holy place and we should treat it with that kind of respect and holiness. There's other names for God in the Old Testament and the New, but Jehovah Nissa, is that right, Brian? Nissa. Stands guard over you. And in Psalm 16:8, I will keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. God's always watching us. We know that. Elohim, the one who created you. In Revelations, day and night, they never stop saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." This is just repeated over and over in Revelation. And I just encourage you, if you want to really enjoy studying Revelations, Monday night Bible study is really, really good, and anybody's welcome. El Shaddai is the God Almighty. In Psalms, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And that fear means respect and knowing that holiness. And when you get to that point, there's the wisdom. Everything in this Bible teaches you how to live every day of your life. Oops, I keep going backwards, huh? So the other thing is, once you know him, you have to talk to him. You have to listen to him. That's that common relationship. In Matthew, but when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who's unseen. Then your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so it will not be obvious to everyone that you're trying to be righteous and holy and fasting, but it's only to the Father who's unseen. And your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you. Look how much it tells how God is so pleased when he sees us worshiping him. When we make time. And how many of you have that prayer closet where, or a room or something where you can get alone and talk to God and listen to him? I think we're moving into a time in our world that we've never seen before. And I think we need to have that kind of a relationship to know what we should do. The economy, the wars, the diseases. You're going to need to be that close to God to hear his voice. The whole worship theme, its definition is undivided and intensive devotion to God. And when you do that, you draw closer to him. It's like ongoing all day long, that you're talking to him like a friend, like when I lose my glasses or something. I have found more things, like my car keys and stuff, when I, God, show me where these are. I don't know where I laid them. And I find them. And I think he cares about the little things. When we come to him, he hears it and he won't turn us away. Psalm says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. You know, that's David, and we know David was a man after God's own heart, like Brian always says. But that kind of a relationship where you are constantly seeing, even just looking at nature, when you get up in the morning, you look out or look at a sunset, beautiful colors, how do you not praise God? It's a normal part of uninterrupted worship. Remember in Luke, Anna. Remember the story about her in the temple. Widow for 84 years, and she never left the temple. Continued to worship there day and night with times of fasting and prayer. That's focus. She only had one thing in her mind, and that was to be close to God. We do intercessory prayer on Monday nights. When we know somebody that's hurting, sick, needs a touch from God, even if they don't always first look to God, we can stand in the gap for them. And you think about the whole book of Esther, how God worked every detail out, starting with a little orphan girl that he ended up helping her, that she was queen of the land. And when Haman got the decree to wipe out the Jews, she was the one who went to the king and stopped it. But she asked all her people, fast and pray with me. In 2 Samuel, David begged God on behalf of his son. Remember when he had the affair with Bathsheba. She got pregnant. He married her, but her baby boy died. And even David, he fasted. He went inside and he spent the night lying on the ground. His heart, he repented. His heart was made right, but there's always a reaction for sin. There's always consequences. His baby died. Sometimes the answer from God is yes, sometimes no, and sometimes later. And I think later is harder to take than the no's. But if you have that connection with God, you know he's got this. And that whatever he says is the right way to go. You need to read your Bible. That's how God speaks to you. How many times, Teresa, we've read a passage and it's like, I have read this over and over many times, and this never stuck out like this to me. God can take your circumstances and lead you to a verse that just meets you where you need it. And you've read it before and it never jumped out like that, but that's how God works. And I say, read it every day. Danny knows I take my mornings, and he does not ask me to do anything till I'm done with Bible study, because I make my pot of coffee and I sit down for hours until I feel like I've got it, and many cups of coffee. But I love that time, that quiet time. And his songs, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my pathway. This is your roadmap, people. This verse really stands out to me when I think of lamp, because it's hard to compute that. Does that make as much sense to you? Because you've never carried a lamp in your life. But let me tell you, when you're coon hunting, and Pam and I used to always go when I was about junior high, want to go with Dad coon hunting. And I'm sure he loved taking lots of kids. But he would get out. You wait in the truck. I'm going to get out. And if they tree anything, I'll come and get you. Well, one night, he's the only one that had the lantern. He come back to the truck. And he said, okay, hurry up. Come on. They got a coon tree. So he goes off and leaves us. Pam and I have no light. But we think we can go running right up after Dad because we could see the light. All of a sudden, I'm flat on my face on the ground, and I look over, and she's the same way. So there had to be some kind of a big divot we didn't see, and we both landed straight in our face, and that's how it is in life. You can end up straight on your face when you're not letting God light your path. And it's because of this in Hebrews, I think. Hebrews says, for the word of God is living. It's active and sharper than a two-edged sword. And that's sharp if it's cutting both ways, you know? It pierces and divides the soul and spirit, joints and marrow, as it judges the thoughts and purposes of the heart. We've got some important decisions here to make in harmony. A lot of us are worried about what conference might do to our church. We're, you know, we don't have a preacher. Here I am. There's a lot of things up in the air. We need a revival, which we're having at the end of the month. Look on your calendars. We've got George Johnson coming for the first few days, and then Brian Odie's going to finish the last couple of days. We need to invite people, the neighborhood. We need to show up to get that fire going again, because we may be having to go meet in homes or Dwight's garage, whatever. We still keep our focus on God. James says, draw close to God and he will draw close to you. It's a mutual thing. He never turns you away. If you take the step to get closer, he will be there. even Deuteronomy, clear back in Moses, he's, you know, telling the people, what, and this is like, really, we should know this. What other nation is so great as to have their God near them the way our Lord God is near us whenever we pray to him? And you think about, as we read that in Revelations, and everybody up there is falling on their faces, worshiping God. Every time we pray, he's that close to us. Thessalonians, Paul's saying, continually be in prayer. I think my other version said, pray always. In everything, be thankful, because this is God's will for you in the Messiah Jesus. So when you hear from God, how do you hear? Everything we've been reading in Ezekiel and Revelation is just like thunder, roaring, rushing waters. It's very powerful. It's like you don't miss it, like a lightning bolt. But then in Elijah's case, in this here in 1 Kings, it was that still small voice. Remember, he said it wasn't in the fire. It wasn't in the wind. It was that still small voice. And that's what I hear. I don't get God verbally out loud talking to me, but it's that small voice that I hear when I'm reading the Bible. And it's like, yeah. And it's just amazing. And then when you get in that kind of a relationship, Romans, consequently, faith comes from hearing the message. And the message is heard through the word about Christ. Your faith grows as you take a step toward him. Your faith grows as you're getting closer and closer. It's like a pyramid steps, not like ladders. You're not going a parallel. You're getting closer to him. You feel him more and more. You hear him. I think in Jiminy Cricket in Pinocchio, remember the little guy on his shoulder? That's how the Holy Spirit is. He's always there. He's always trying to guide you in the right way. And it's up to us whether we follow him, whether we listen. So we have to obey God. We have to make this part personal. Action on our part. Matthew 28. Therefore, he says, and look at all the action words in this. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I am always with you to the very end of the age. No matter what happens, he's going to be there for us. So we each, every one of us, needs to examine our life and where are we at on this, I don't know what you want to call it, area of worship. Are we down at the bottom that never hear from God? I study once a week. I read the Bible occasionally, you know? Or is this something where we are feeling every part of this that we've read? Because this is scripture. This is what God wants it to be. Peter and the apostles were thrown in jail many times, and they'd get out and say, they'd tell them, do not preach that name of Jesus anymore. And he says, we must obey God rather than human beings. He didn't care. He was so firmly planted in his relationship with God that he didn't care if they threw him in jail the next day. He didn't care if they beheaded him. He was going to do what God wanted him to do. And in John, Jesus replied, anyone who loves me will obey my teachings. My Father will love them, and we, that's Jesus and God, will come to them and make our home with them. How personal is that? How many times have you had someone come and stay in your home? You wouldn't have a stranger. It's got to be someone you know and trust, right? or maybe not at all because I don't let anybody in my house. So again, how do you focus on God? Where are you at in your worship and daily living with Him? When the rapture happens, whenever it happens, there are instantly going to be Christians taken out, and the whole world is going to have a big pause because they're not going to be able to explain it away. I'd like to see the news media, when they make up stories half the time, what are they going to call it? Alien abduction? I don't know. But you don't want to be left behind. Don't be one of these, what I call the pew warmers, that you come to church, but you're not going to do anything more than that. And I listened to Davey Wilkerson's this week. He's dead now, but they still have his messages on. And this is what he was talking about. Have you come to the end of your expectations for Christ? Do you expect nothing more than to be saved by the power and grace? Does your Christ end at just enough strength to make it through another day? Does he end for you at a place of occasional peace and joy in a life lived mostly under Satan's harassment? All of these passages in God's Word persuade me that my Jesus is no bigger than my requests. Sadly, many believers make Christ look insignificant and powerless by their unbelief. So if you feel a need to recommit your life, maybe, to take that step forward, there's always people that will pray. The church will pray with you. Just talk to someone. So let's go in prayer. Father, thank you for this word. Your promises throughout the whole Bible are so great, and we need to claim them. We need to be so close to you that nothing can shake us and keep our eyes off you. Help us here in the church to make the right decisions. Pray for our country. Pray for the nations around the world, the Christians that are suffering and being persecuted. Well, we just pray that our hearts will be ready for whatever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let's stand and sing our closing song. It's 335, but it's mainly the choruses. You want to stand up? I can't start this because it'll kick right into the song. And the things
the Rob this week. Have a good week. Draw close to God, and He will draw close to you. Go in peace.
Peace and love, brother. Let's bring those stars.